Hi, and welcome to my presentation on natural nets. This is work mostly done by Joshua and Eddie, and then basically supervised by Nelson and myself from the University of Alberta. So our world is basically using information retrieval tools and natural language processing tools to process code and process it on a computer and deal with the limited computation we have, as well as limited memory. So the point is that we're going to treat code as natural language text or text that were typically indexed by IR tools. So essentially what we're going to talk about is basically bimodal program analysis with a naturalness lens. We're going to talk about syntax error detection, syntax error correction, and crash report clustering. So let's get into it. So if I give you this phrase, "I'm a little blank," and I ask you to fill in blank, you'll probably think of something, but you didn't think of Southwest Airlines. You probably heard like a record needle scratch in your brain when I said, "I'm a little Southwest Airlines," because it doesn't really make sense. It seems kind of strange. You could think of something more appropriate. And that's what language models can do. Like an n-gram language model or another kind of language model could basically estimate what should be in that blank, and they'd decide how perplexing it is. So if we do the same thing on program source code for blank in range, open paren, zero, comma, you probably are going to choose an IRAJ, and based on reaping GitHub Python, you'd probably get the same results from a language model. But if I gave you for four in range, that would be confusing. In Python, you're not allowed to have four as an identifier. It's a reserved word. So the general gist is that we can train a language model in good code and it'll know it pretty well. And then when we give it bad code, it'll be surprised by that. Usually our language models are going to be basically 10-gram models, and we're going to use some kind of smoothing, and we're going to use surprise or cross-entropy or perplexity. And we're going to operate in two worlds. We have a statically typed world where things can be compile time checked, and we have a dynamically typed world where we optimistically code because we think it's faster. In our static world, our types are known, and we have access to oracles. Oracles can tell us if something is a valid program. For instance, Java's oracle would be Java C. Java C answers, this is a valid program. Dynamically typed languages typically are optimistic programs. They're meant to work. They use duct taping, types can change at runtime, they engage in lots of kinds of behavior, but typically they don't have oracles. For instance, in the case of Python, there is no oracle. You can't actually ask Python, is this a Python program? It'll try to run it, and it'll run as best as could, and if it doesn't hit any misspellings and doesn't hit any functions that you have syntax errors in, it'll be just fine. So does this method of using an n-gram model actually work? Well, it actually works quite well. So if we ask the model about this kind of code, whereby we're missing an open brace on the second line, you can see two closed braces at the bottom. What it does is it basically finds that, yes, in the middle of that n-gram, it doesn't make sense. So its cross entropy is a lot lower. And so we go for the high entropy ones and we take a look. And this works on token replacement. This works on token insertion. And it can work in Python. So right in the middle, there's this bottom number equals, and there's a little caret that indicates where it was. So that's where Python got confused, but also our model can figure that one out. All right, so how do we evaluate these models? Well, typically we use MRR scores, where it's mean reciprocal rank. So you rank a bunch of locations, and the right location, we give a score that's a reciprocal of its rank. So if it was the first one, we get 1 out of 1. Its reciprocal rank is 1. If it's the second one, the reciprocal rank is 0.2, is 0.5, right? So if we train on ourselves with an n-gram model, remember, it's not going to remember everything. It works pretty well. Everything's above half. If we test on the new stuff versus the old stuff, like everything in the major revision, everything in the minor revision, well, we get we get pretty good results. For truly new files, there is a bunch of surprise because we don't know the vocabulary. And then on changed files, files that already exist, we get really high scores. So basically, if it's seen it before, it does really well. If it knows the tokens, it does well. If it doesn't know the terminology of the project, such as we're asking it to find problems in ANT using a leucine corpus, it doesn't do as well, but it can still find the syntax errors in like the top four. It's worse at estimating. Now with Python, we can't use MRR, we use accuracy, because it only suggests one. So it's basically, was Python, was it right or not? So UC Python versus UC Java, they're comparable. UC Python is probably a little bit worse. The MRRs of the Java are pretty high, to be honest. And then on each operation, by themselves, they're pretty good. For Python, each operation is pretty good on its own. So we conclude that when you train a language model of working source code, syntax errors just aren't natural. And this led us to the idea that we can just use these language models to actually fill in the fix. So if they find the spot, let's fix the spot. So Eddie, what he wanted to do is he wanted to fix one syntax error and find the exact location, suggest the fix, like you should fix something here. And so he basically says one syntax error is an edit distance of one from a syntactically valid file, whether it's addition, deletion, substitution. So an example would be an addition, maybe you delete that thing, you could delete that one, you could substitute it. But we want to suggest fixes without handwritten rules. We don't want to come up with the rules. So we're going to train a neural network in this case instead of an ngram model. We're going to train on JavaScript, and we're going to have it suggest where the problem is and also suggest the solution. So what we're going to do is we're going to estimate a function, and this function is going to tell us what the next token is going to be. So given function error result, it's going to tell semicolon. Given something like a for loop where we're in the middle of it, it's going to give us a semicolon to finish off there. And then after the length, maybe it'll give us an I or a plus plus. And we're going to use LSTMs to do this. LSTMs, they're recurrent neural nets. Basically, it's part of deep learning now where you have hidden layers. And for the LSTM, you have a layer that isn't just forward, it's recurrent. It links back to itself, so it can feed back into itself. And then the LSTM is where we add a little memory cell on there too. So now we have not only feedbacking to itself, so we have edges for that, we now have a memory cell with edges such that you can store a value there. And it kind of learns the parameters of how to store a value. Now, what we're going to do is we're going to mine a bunch of GitHub, we're going to parse a bunch of JavaScript, and we're going to train a brain on that stuff. And because languages are complicated in neural nets, what we're going to do is we're going to use a limited abstract vocabulary that relies on the idea of open and closed tokens. True and false are basically reserved words. You use them. They have a Boolean meaning. Those are an example of a closed token, whereas an identifier is an example of an open token. So when you lex something, you'll pretty well know if it's a closed token or open token. Java is pretty similar. So what we do to prepare for our LSTM is we have to index all these tokens. And we have to index, well, actually the abstraction of the tokens. So first we take the original source code, greeting equals hello, and then we tokenize it, then we normalize it, so we throw out the stuff we don't care about. So we don't care about the value of a string, so we just say it's a string. And then we now get identifier equals string semicolon, and then we encode that as 3021, and then we encode that as a one hot vectors or tensors, whatever you want, and we give that to the LSTM. Now, the LSTM, we want to produce a categorical distribution of what the next thing is going to be. And our LSTM basically has, we give it 20 tokens and over the vocabulary, and we have 300 hidden units inside and dropout, then softmax, its output is categorical distribution, our loss function is categorical cross entropy, And we use that to estimate our function. And what we're going to do is we're going to actually train two LSTMs, a backwards and a forwards. So the forwards one will detect a suffix given a prefix, and the backwards one will detect a prefix given a suffix. And so we'll basically get two suggested tokens, and then for each token in the file, we measure the disagreement, we collect the top k examples of highest disagreement, and then we investigate those. So what's going to happen is, in this case, the highlighted pink parenthesis, we're going to have basically the forward one is going to say no, that should be something else, and then the previous model is expecting that, so they're like, no, you're wrong. So basically they're in disagreement because one expected it, the other one did not. And so for the top k disagreements, you create a series of fixes, either assume token addition or token deletion, and we engage in tenfold cross-validation. So to evaluate, in this case for JavaScript, we use mutation testing. You take a valid token stream for the validation set, you apply a random edit, and you ensure that it can actually find and fix these. So you can either add something, you can delete something, you can substitute it. What the tool looks like is you give it a snippet, you run the program, and it tells you with you know some text markup where this stuff is. So how well does this work? Well, we got a MRR around 0.3 to 0.5 for JavaScript, so that's pretty nice. Typically, it works the best on insertions. Deletions are harder because the fix for a delete is an insert, right? So you have to actually come up with the right one. And then substitutions, they don't happen a lot. Now, if we do it on Java, what we find is that this model isn't working out all that great. We get poor localization, and then our fixes aren't exactly great. So when we look at Ingram models, how they do on Java, we actually find that in terms of abstract stuff, like there's a missing identifier, we've got an MRR about 0.3. That's pretty excellent. That means in the top three, you've got a suggestion for a fix. But really, if you go and look at the plot, it's more like a third of the time it's got a suggestion for a fix that's legit. Then if we use the entire vocabulary rather than the abstract vocabulary, we actually get a worse location performance, which is interesting. And our true fixes are worse. So maybe the best thing to do is to combine the concrete true fix with the abstract. So while we conclude, LSTMs are good for do work for modeling good code and finding syntax errors. It depends on the language, though, it seems. Maybe identifier-heavy languages are an issue. Identifiers are still an issue because you don't have the right identifier. The LSTMs are not as flexible as NL models such as Ngram models. And the neat thing is that we exploit the same models for location as you can for fixes. So that's fun and kind of surprising results in deep learning. Now, next up is basically using information retrieval to dedupe crash reports. So we've got this problem where we've got a company, they've got a popular software product, it goes out, it crashes on numerous devices, the crashes come back. They're thrown into a crash database. And what we want to do is we want to basically bucket every one of these bugs into the appropriate bug that caused it. And we face issues of scale. So Mozilla says that they get more than 2 million crashes per week, and on a bad day they can get like a million crashes. And it's infeasible to hire anyone to look at it. What we really want is given the crashes, we want them bucketed in the right bucket such that the bucket has all the crashes related to that problem and no other crashes. But we don't actually have that. What happens is we just have these crashes kicking around throughout time. So we have to try to rebucket those. Furthermore, we don't know the name of the bucket, so precision and recall don't necessarily work the same. So we're going to engage in a clustering-based kind of precision and recall called BQ precision and recall. And we basically want to make sure that the buckets contain the crashes, and we want buckets that are pure, right? And we don't want too much bucket splitting. For instance, if we ask for high BQ precision, we would get buckets that are pure, they have the right bug in them, but there's too many buckets representing one bug. Whereas a high B-cube recall, we'd have buckets that contain everything to do with that bug, but they also contain other bugs. What we want is kind of a balance where we get buckets that aren't mixing it up too much. And we want it now, so we can't use n squared. Everything's got to be basically n log n or better. So we can only spend about log n time per crash, and we have to deal with at least 2 million a week. Furthermore, it's an online problem. We don't really know the future, and so when we evaluate, we have to evaluate over time as things are coming in, because you don't know that there's a huge cluster in the future, and you also don't necessarily know when to make a cluster. And we don't want developers to categorize the crashes. It should be unsupervised, because frankly, the supervised data is lacking. There's very little out there. Another problem is it's non-stationary, so your rate can increase, and also the need to make a new bucket or many new buckets can change. How do others do it? Well, some of them do signature generation. It's pretty fast, it's not clear it's accurate, and it involves a lot of handwritten rules, and just about everyone engages in it. There's a bunch of suggestions for n squared stuff, but that was never meant to actually work in reality. So what was interesting is there was this paper by Lurch et al, and they basically said, hey, if you want to deduplicate like bug reports and stuff, why don't you just use off-the-shelf information retrieval like TF-IDF? And that's what they did. So they just basically represented every document using TF-IDF, the terms in the document using TF-IDF, and then the benefit of it is that things that are kind of rare or new have a higher score, whereas things that are in every document, like the B2 of in and those kinds of words, they get discounted a lot, so you don't really pay attention to them. You don't even need to remove them. So we thought, well, Lurch et al., they seem pretty smart. Why don't we exploit their work and do it for bugs? So what we're really doing is we're doing basically naturalness applied to crash reports. So what we want to do is we want to basically pose crash reports in such a way that it works well with IR models, which have typically worked well with text. So we do have this kind of context, so we can break this down. Lurch et al., what they do is they just break it up into words. So this is the word, this is Lurch tokenization, and we suggested also space tokenization. And we also suggested camel case tokenization. And what happens is you break these things down and you get different tokens and you get basically a bag of words. And what we're going to do is we're basically going to represent each crash as a bag of words. And then we're going to query the database for these crashes. And if they're similar, according to a threshold, we'll group them together into the same bucket, right? So basically, the first time you bucket something, you'll give it a bucket ID, right? So if we see a bug and nothing is similar to it, we give it a bucket ID. And then the next bug that comes in that's similar to it, we give it its bucket ID, right? So we propagate the buckets that way. So based on this kind of ad hoc clustering, who won? Well, Lurch's techniques typically worked. If we just paid attention to like top of the stack, the file, the addresses, never really worked out that great on a big data set like from Ubuntu. But what we found is that Lurch and Space C and Camel C all worked together, but Camel C pretty well dominated all the results, which was kind of nice. And furthermore, with Camel C, based on that thresholding I was talking about for the bucketing, like you have a threshold for how close something is in terms of a distance, like a Lucene score. Difference of Lucene score. By playing with that, you can basically get this dominating curve of camel tokenization. So the TF-IDF thing did the greatest. And what's interesting is it doesn't care about the structure of the data. Typically, when you do crash reports, you pay attention to the top of the stack. And also by adding the contextual information, you can basically break things down by, you know, affected systems. And most of the other papers, they don't do it, but it turned out to be pretty good in this one. And furthermore, it meets all our performance requirements. So essentially, by posing artifacts naturally as a naturalness problem, We can apply IRA-based techniques, and these techniques typically disregard stack order, the context matters, and they're pretty fast. So that's pretty cool. So in total, what I've talked about is I've talked about mixing NLP and IR and code all together such that we can do interesting, we can compute interesting problems and probabilities on CPUs. This is helpful because it lets us to train models of code, especially good code, and we exploit the fact that the bad code is surprising. We use this to even fix syntax errors by using the same model to suggest what token should actually fit in there. And then we also apply the same kind of naturalness idea of, you know, taking our knowledge of the software and the artifacts and the fact that people like to name things certain ways, exploiting that such that we get a good tokenization, such that we can exploit information retrieval techniques well. So, language models that find errors, language models that fix errors, posing source code tokens as natural language, source code artifacts as natural language, the cluster errors for IR. That's typically what we're doing. And I hope some of this was interesting to you. All right, thanks.